Ladies and gentlemen, I know it's always difficult to come back after lunch, but let's say thank you to Fairmont Hotel for great food and beverages and start our third panel. So, we've heard a general framework from the governor of the Central Bank of Ukraine, Valeria Kontareva, and now it's time to drill down and listen to the top bankers in the country. The scope of this panel is pretty broad and covers the ongoing crisis in the banking system, central bank reforms, current and expected interest rates. A solid part of the panel will be focused on the opportunities for Ukrainian companies to raise capital from the banks or via Eurobonds. So let me introduce Vladyslav Rashkovan, the board member of the National Bank of Ukraine and director of the Department of Strategy and Reforms. Vladyslav is a very experienced banker as he managed UniCredit Bank, one of the largest Ukrainian banks with foreign capital in the market. So thank you very much.
I hope you managed UniCredit Bank. I was a CFO there. But for me, it's more important that I'm here as a moderator representing the National Bank, being moderating this session with such a distinguished guest. And let me start from the introduction of people who we have here today. We have Rufat Alimardanov from IFC. We have Evgeniya Chemerys from CEO of the Agricole, Dominique from BNP Paribas, and we have Sergey Sosnov, the CEO and founder of Zen Assets. You know, in order to be a little bit provocative and to make the dots between this panel session and the previous one, I want to ask you the question which was given by Andrei Bulot from Deloitte. What did you and your companies did during this year to improve the situation in Ukraine and to make the life in Ukraine better? Rufat.
Okay, thank you. Well, what we've done to help Ukraine, when we speak about IFC, last fiscal year ending June, was in fact a record year for us in terms of investments and the credits. With the amount of total amount of investments about $480 million in US dollar equivalent. In addition, and these are long term, mostly long term loans and quasi equities, not too many equity investments, but mostly long term loans to various sectors, mostly focusing on agribusiness and export oriented companies. In addition to this, we've been also providing advice both to the government and to the private sector on various topics, again, including the agribusiness access to finance, to the banking sector, to help them also lend to the agri sector, and also general investment climate improvement. You know that the doing business ranking for Ukraine improved. I wouldn't attribute that solely, obviously, to our work, but we obviously played a role there. Partially, obviously, Ukraine benefited from the change in the methodology, but partly it was due to the reforms, mostly on the tax payments front. That Ukraine benefited from. Obviously, there's a way to go. We can speak about this later, but perhaps these are the main things that we've done. Is it enough? Probably Ukraine needs much more, but we need to all obviously roll our sleeves and work together to help Ukraine.
Thanks. Again.
Hello, everybody. Of course, if you speak about what I personally did, I would prefer to say what my bank did for Ukraine during this year, and I believe that presence and continuation of work of such sustainable, such reliable and big European bank in Ukraine, it's already something. Sometimes I believe that our work, the work a bit better than our diplomats, because in all times, whatever government we have, whatever central bankers we have, people from banks with Western capital demonstrated to their headquarters, and it means demonstrated to Europeans and other Western countries, that it's possible to work with us, that we are honest, we are not corrupted, we we are competitive and we are competent. So our competency is a key. So the fact that we run French bank in Ukraine, being still profitable in such situation, keeping risks under control, keeping NPL, although it's increased and will continue to increase, but keeping it on acceptable level, I believe this is something. And also, I would like to mention that apart my duties in the Agricole team, I'm also head of committee on tax and accounting in Independent Association of Ukrainian Banks. And here we had, believe me, plenty work during this year, because all this turmoil in our legislation, when some laws or provision and laws were introduced, then canceled, then change again introduced, really we had to monitor all these changes and not to permit them to make banking system even more fragile than it is now.
Thanks again. Dominique, you already quite a number of years in Ukraine. This year, what did you bring to Ukraine?
Look, I was going to answer like Evgeniya. You see me today. Is a commitment to Ukraine, right? Now, for any, the important things is the discussions we're having, you know, on the side on how we can improve things, how we can make the country adapt to this new situation and walk away from the Soviet past. It's a difficult exercise for everyone, but I was a bit, I was listening to Timothy Ash earlier, who was saying that he came back with a feeling that the situation was difficult. Over lunch we were discussing about the situation back in 91, 92. I still have some coupons without numbers. And then there was no banking sector, there was, you know, you couldn't see light in the evening. I mean, so if you remember what it was 20 years ago, we say, of course the situation is difficult. But we believe, the fact that we are here means that we believe in Ukraine. We never envisaged selling the bank. We are here to stay. And I think if this is not a commitment, I don't know what it is. That's it.
Thank you. Now, when people ask myself why I joined the National Bank, I'm always answering that I'm a believer, you know, that we can make this happen and we can make it better. Sergey.
First of all, let me make a disclaimer. I'm not a banker anymore. I used to be a banker for 6 years, worked with Goldman Sachs in London. And now what we're doing, actually trying to change the way banking or part of banking is done globally. In terms of doing something for Ukraine, I know the answer, but let me tell you a little bit. We work in Europe and for European clients first and foremost. But what we're doing for Ukraine, we're taking Ukrainian DNA and we're injecting it into a global financial system, because the large chunk and the core part of our team has Ukrainian background. And I guess that's a good start. You know, something I think we all should think about. There is a lot of talk. It's the second conference in 2 days. And people do talk a lot. There is a lot of advice being given to president, parliament, judicial system, bankers, everyone. I think what we all should do is just get something done. You know, like if we can build one company in Europe using Ukrainian specialists, that's already good stuff. Hopefully we're going to change system for the better. But you know, giving advice is cheap. You know, people, A, they don't listen because they know it already. You don't think people know what we talked about for 2 days. Like, everyone knows what has to be done. The point is about getting things done. So I think the best thing that anyone can do for Ukraine this year, next year, or whatever, get things done.
Fully agree with you. But if I may ask, and it's my question to you, can you get close to these people? Because they did something for this year for Ukraine, and they were just shy to answer the question of Andrei. Thanks a lot for what I where I want to start the session with one slide. It's just really one slide which we showed to the which we showed last week, and Evgeniya was participating in that meeting. It was quite a remarkable meeting. It was in Brussels, in the office of the European Commission, where the Ukrainian bankers, together with the people who were representing their parent companies, were discussing with National Bank, with EBRD, with European Investment Bank, the banking reform in Ukraine. And again, it was hosted by European Commission, which was very much welcoming this initiative. And they said, look, the National Bank is speaking to us in Brussels, in English, representing, you know, the foreign banks, is already some step forward. So we already do something, really, to go there is definitely not enough, and there is a program which we also discussed already several times about the reforms. But I want just to show you one slide, just to sum up very, very light, very limited, and very, you know, selected agenda of the National Bank today for the banking sector, and later we go to the discussing different topics from there with our panelists, if you don't mind. So what we have today, where we are forced to have battles on different fields. First, we have two big big factors which impacting the banking sector today is the macro shock and the confidence. And you know, I deleted because another factor here was a war. I mean, as a factor which affecting this, and I was again use the war as one of the excuses for the Ukrainian situation. It's definitely not an excuse, but believe me, it's a factor. It's a factor which definitely worsening the confidence in Ukraine and definitely worsening the macro factor, but macro situation. But if you don't mind, I deleted the war as a factor, just not to have an excuse. So what we have about the confidence? From one side, the war. From another side, the inability sometimes to make the reforms in Ukraine, and some beliefs or lack of beliefs that something will happen, brought to the uncertainty of people in the future. For sure, tanks doesn't help much to the confidence and the future aggression and information wars, which was discussed in another conference yesterday, does not help much to the confidence. And we have a bank runs. I mean, many of you know the figures about how many deposits were taken from the banking sector, and believe me, it's a big shock for the banking sector today. Together, we have a confidence on the interbank market and the debt market. The interbank market mostly closed today because the banks don't trust each other. We already said today that 26 banks were sent to insolvency this year, and most probably there will be some others if the shareholders will not support the banks. The debt market for Ukrainian companies is a bit closed, and we will discuss it today, how to unlock it. And it doesn't bring much, again, to the banking sector stability. So which brings to the liquidity crisis somehow. What we see sometimes with the interest rates, what we see the banks which are failing, is also the result of the liquidity crisis. Liquidity crisis brings that some banks require the National Bank refinancing, you know, in order to support, especially if you speak about the systemically important banks. And also we hope that the current shareholders will support their banks with money in order to support their banks. The macro shock, the macro shocks. The situation in Donbas, and not so much in Crimea area, but in Donbas and Lugansk, brings big macroeconomic shocks to Ukraine, linked to the situation. Is not only the uncertainty or the confidence there is problem. There is really destruction for the capacity. There is disruption for industrial production there. And we were discussing today in the previous session with Andrei the interest, the exchange rates. I mean, and there is a normal logic that if exchange rates go, the greenland depreciates, there is a big potential positive effect for the exporters. But believe me, no matter which rate will be, if the company is destroyed in Donetsk and you don't have an access for the people to start working, there is no way that the exchange rate will help this company to start working again. So this is a big factor for the macroeconomics, and also the trade war which we have with Russia. You know that many of our companies, they are very much linked to the Russian in the past. And it's not about only import substitution. is also about the change of the markets, which doesn't make it possible, you know, to make in 3-5 months, which we should have enough. The capacity destruction and trade war brings to the GDP fall, and you know, there is a forecast for this year about 7%, and believe me, in September we have seen even the lower, our forecast was about 9%, but we start seeing now in September and October some resilience and some recovery of the production. And we hope that by year end it will slightly improve. But definitely the GDP fall also brings to the fiscal deficit and the need for the country, for the government to finance the not only the running costs but also the debt. And this brings to the necessity to issue some, as we name it, local QE. So there is some support. We don't name it, we finance the National Bank. The National Bank is not financing the government, but in fact, you know, the banking sector issuing the money to buy the local T-bills is somehow financing the budget deficits, including the Naftogaz case. Somebody is asking what is the effect for the for the exchange rates. You don't need to forget that there is not only, as it was mentioned, it's not only the bank run or trade war, there is and the imbalance of payment, there is also the issue of the capital outflow. And the capital outflow is making a big pressure for the exchange rate because the capital goes in different directions, starting from money laundering, which we try to stop, but there is also the lack of the commitment to the country, and there is intercompany loans, which we, in the past was like 120% the rollover ratio. Now what we see is about 70-75%. It means that even the companies which were financing the local subsidiaries, even the parent companies, they start decreasing their financing to Ukraine. This is about the commitment to the country, and they sometimes they substitute this with local funding. For sure, all of these together brings the effect for FX devaluation and the depreciation of the lira. Both, I mean, local QE, I mean the refinancing from the banks, and also the problems of balance of payment. Everything makes a pressure for a given exchange rate. What else? I mean, Livna, and this is coming again, coming back to banking, the Livna devaluation and GDP fall bring together increase of NPL. Evgeniya said that we can still try to manage it, but the NPL increases, and we don't forget that we still did not solve the issue of 2009 NPL stock, and we need, and the increasing of NPL makes a pressure for the capital, and the capital is, and we're already discussing today also with the government about the capitalization plans of the banks. This is the first small picture of the banking sector, but it's not full yet, because we also have the problem of local peculiarities, as we name it, nuances. Is local corporate governance and behavior also to have in Ukraine. And unfortunately, what we found in the banking sector, which was the issue which was not solved in the past, is the ownership transparency. And we worked together with World Bank for several years already in order to improve it. But believe me or not, national banks sometimes formally or legally doesn't know the owners of the banks. We try to improve it. We try to solve this issue today, and we even send the letters to the banks which have the most ridiculous cases of the ownership structures in order to bring them the legal structure and the owners more clear to the national bank. But still, this is a problem. And the second biggest problem which we have in the recent corporate governance issue is related party lending. If you don't know the real owner of the bank, you cannot control later if he or she doesn't give money back to his own company, and therefore just stripping out the capital in the banking sector from the bank. Therefore, if you don't have the capital in your bank, there is zero incentive for you to recapitalize this bank, because you can just bring the keys to the national bank and say, okay, the bank is yours, take it. And therefore, we have the problem that from one side, there is a capital need in many banks. From another side, there is a very low incentives for the capital, incentive for capital increase. And it brings to the insolvency. Okay. local behaviors bring the problem that corruption, unfortunately, which was already said today in different occasions, is a problem in Ukraine, both in the banking sector, not only this, I mean the regulatory area, but in the banking sector and the legal judicial system is a big problem. The banks cannot protect their creditor rights. And again, the government contributor today said about this, that this is one of our initiatives. First is really to make the law which could help to protect the creditors. And again, the law, the corruption brings to the increase of NPL provisions, brings to the capital needs, and brings to insolvency of the banks. So, and last, and what we have on top? On top we have that if there is insolvent banks, some banks will go either to deposit guarantee fund, so therefore there is should be another link with fiscal deficit, because the money should come from the Ministry of Finance to recapitalize the deposit guarantee fund and to give money back to the depositors. From another side, there is a nationalization of banks, which should be systemically important, because you cannot allow them to go bust because they are too important for the banking sector. Do you think it helps us with the confidence? For sure not. But this is a path which we need to go through, because without this, there will be no better banking system, and we will not be able to further to the, to restart lending. And we need to solve all of this puzzle at the same moment. This is only one picture. I have others, but I will not show you. You know, just to show you that this is the agenda of the National Bank today. And now we will go to our panelists to think how indifferent of this puzzle. How shall we live and what to be done further in order to try to solve some of these issues? Okay? Rufat, which part of this picture do you like to speak about? Just as I see commitment to the country.
Well, what we like is that we see that there's a plenty of scope for us to show what we can do and try to help, because we cannot afford, as IFC at the World Bank, no one can, but we especially cannot afford leading the market when we have issues. This is our role. Just to maybe underline the problem there, we are long-term lenders, I said it earlier, but when we saw the situation here in Ukraine in spring, we realized that what is needed in the system is short-term funding to help companies to fund their working capital needs, especially if you look at the agri sector, which could easily contribute quickly to the foreign exchange earnings of the country. So we developed a facility, include 5 banks, some existing clients, some new clients, to offer them short-term funding so they would in turn offer funding to their clients. And we tried to make it as quick and as flexible as possible. Initial interest was positive, but along the way, we realized it all faded away. No one was interested in lending. Basically, they came back and said, we're liquid, or we're not taking risks, so it didn't work. So why it's not working? We all know. The banks are burdened with NPLs, and depending on what classification, what definition you use, you could talk about 20 to 40%. If you account for rescheduled loans, it could be probably 45% even, if not higher. So how could you solve this issue? We've been working on this issue for years, together with the World Bank and EBRD, with the regulators. And other agencies here. We've come a long way. There have been some successful improvements, but we're still not there. What we're trying to come up with now is create an asset management company that would assume, obviously, NPLs, but the issue is that if you transfer them at the market prices, the banking system would not obviously swallow this. They will collapse, let's just call it this way. Proper name. So there should be some way, or someone said the following phrase at the earlier session, that we need to have a burden sharing. So we need to find the burden sharing structure where all of us pitch in and try to solve the issue. So we are willing to play this role together with other IFIs and actually invest in this venture. But obviously banks will need to take their share of burden and assume those losses. To the extent they can obviously withstand. And there should be missing component, it should come from somewhere, from subordinated type of a structure or that, or maybe even from the government, something to discuss. In fact, next week we're organizing a meeting where EBRD, IFC, the World Bank will be sitting together with the regulators, with the NBU, and then we'll be discussing what can be done, because there are lots of initiatives in parallel. We need to bring them all together and make sure we do it in a coordinated way. So I'm not going to go through the structure itself because it's evolving. We need to agree between ourselves who can do what. But certainly we need to find a burden sharing mechanism and then make this work and make the market actually regulate this. And we're willing to use our role, we and other IFIs, of being a so-called honest broker in this process, because whenever there's a number of agencies involved, there could be some mistrust from one entity or the other that they could be shady deals. And obviously, longer term issue we need to obviously address is the judicial system. That is where the problem actually lies.
Thanks. I think, thank you, Rob. I think the issue of NPL, we just will come back also a little bit later, because this is, it's a bigger problem for the banking sector, both as a stock and as a potential for the future. Evgeniya, did I miss something on this chart? Or maybe you just want to think it's less complicated or should be more complicated?
You know, in fact, this chart is rather full, but the problem is that behind each point, there is the big and big story. It's very difficult to find the point which is more important or less important, because as you see even from the chart, they all are connected. Therefore, I will not in advance to choose whatever part, but I will try to tell something which I want this auditory to understand. Maybe some practical points from the point of view of practical banker, acting banker. No, first of all, I would like for just for 1 second return back to Brussels story, and I would like to thank Vladyslav and Vladyslav as a representative of Central Bank, because for the first time we commercial bankers, especially commercial bankers represented banks with foreign capital, we were not ashamed of our official Ukrainian official representatives on European summit. And this was not even question of English. Yes, it's facilitated because we all speak one language. But what is more important is that all these people speak one financial language and we share same values, meaning anti-corruption fight, meaning transparency, trust, etc. Therefore, it's not only my opinion, because we were 10 or 12 Ukrainian bank over there, and we exchange our views after this conference, and we also talk with our European colleagues, and it was one common opinion that how National Bank was represented in Europe, it was really something which we all should applaud. This is what I did on behalf of my colleagues. Now about this chart. No, first of all, of course, anyway, if I would choose the topic, I would choose from this chapter of confidence. Why? Because confidence or trust is something basic, which is banking is about. Because you know, banking is a trust, and trust without trust there is no banking. But I would say that confidence includes not only trust but also compliance. And I want to explain here what I mean. And I can tell you that the same. Here you see interbank market, which Vladyslav said does not work. And this is really so. Interbank market does not work. By the way, sometimes it facilitates our life. Because if you remember early 90s, what Dominique already did, we should remember that at that time, the biggest business among banks was interbank lending. And all banks were like in one chain. And in this case, the failure of one bank created effect, the domino effect. All other banks were also in troubles. I can remind you Ukraine bank case. Now, not really so, because even if one, even the biggest bank will fail, other banks will continue working. Of course, this will create, if the failure of big bank will create a problem for the whole market, for Ukraine, for people if it's a big retail bank. But it will not, banking system will not collapse immediately. Now about trust. And when we speak about trust, we speak about interest rate. Because if the bank has trust, then it could attract money with smaller interest rate and credit again with smaller interest rate. And using this help economy. This is a real problem now, because this dramatic outflow of deposit, this is what? This is, of course, lack of trust, this is first. But second, it's also political populism, which we faced during this year in a big way and continue to face with. I will explain using last, it's not last, but now it again became a hot issue. Last example, loans in foreign currency. You know, National Bank, every morning till lunch, there is a group of people who make a demonstration, who speak about, still remember, rate 5, accuse National Bank in all problems and devaluation, etc., and insist on conversion. But let's see what does it mean, this conversion. If we convert our assets, then what will happen? I even don't speak about rate, because if we convert, which is now in one of the draft law, we should convert with current rate. If we convert with current rate, then what's the interest for population? No interest at all. If we convert with smaller rate, like 8, for example, then we have to register losses. It will immediately make an influence our capital. And in addition, from one side, in addition, how we convert? It means that we decrease or make shorter our open currency position, which already short. So there is, this is pure populism if you speak only about this, because this is way without solution. And people who listen about such conversation, who read these draft laws, they and understand that banks simply cannot afford such simple conversion, they understand that the only way is to convert simultaneously assets and liabilities. But is it good? Does somebody in this auditorium, I mean from Ukrainian citizen, agree to convert deposits in foreign currency? This is what happened in some other countries, and this was not a good example, you see? So we as a bankers, we are horrified with such perspective. But this is the only way to balance sheet. If you don't do this, you cannot continue. And therefore, I say that it is very important in such situation to avoid any populistic measures without real ground and without agreement, mutual agreement of financial sector. So this is first. Second,
Dominique, we participated with you in many conferences when I was in the commercial sector, and you know very well the banking system, and you have seen how it was developed in the last years. How do you estimate this deepness of this crisis today, and therefore the which of these graphs for you seems the most dangerous, or vice versa, the most easiest maybe to solve now?
Not an easy question, so there won't be an easy answer. We go back in time to understand where we are, because after all, you know, the situation today is a result of what was done before. The first 5 years after independence was just free-fall. The first situation when Ukraine sort of get back on its knees was in 96 when the Evgeniya was introduced. Then you had a bit of growth, foreign banks coming in, corporate banks. And basically a lot left in 99, 2001. In 2001, Ukraine came in one of the best situations it could think of. It had an agreement on low gas price. China just joined the WTO. Steel price went up, and suddenly the steel companies could make profit. Orange Revolution, by the way, came in a way because people thought there was a difference in price when the steel companies were sold to what they were really worth. And because it was a start of the beginning that things were going better. After the Orange Revolution happened just after many countries joined the EU, that is all the countries of Central and Eastern Europe, that were absorbed into the EU. And suddenly Ukraine had one border with Poland, one border with Hungary, one border with Slovakia, which were all members of the EU. Not to mention Romania. The banks started to look eastwards. And they went to Ukraine. Guess what? We all went to Ukraine to buy banks, and banks from everywhere. From Italy, from Austria, from France, from Sweden, from Greece, from Turkey, from Georgia, from Russia, from Scandinavia. Everybody came at a time where liquidity was huge. There was a big bubble being formed in the world. So, we all came, we all competed, it was a big market, and we sort of were collectively, we took part in this bubble that exploded in 2008. After 2008, situation was sort of dealt, but frozen. Reforms were not done. One of the most difficult thing that happened to us was the 107-109 decision by the central bank that killed the market. Why? Because we, as banks, were forced to provision in Evgeniya assets, that is, loans, which were in dollars. That created the open currency position. So, situation was frozen, but the exchange rate was kept at the same level, although inflation was much bigger. So you saw an increase of imports and not so much exports. So the situation was deteriorating. We had a gap, and the explosion, if I can say, happened with Euromaidan. It was just a coincidence. It was deemed to happen. Whether we had had Euromaidan or not, the situation would have exploded one way or another. I mean, financial situation. So now we have a chance to start to rebuild. You don't have chances to start very often. I came to Croatia after the war to start a bank. Then I went to Belgrade, just after the fall of Mr. Milosevic. In your life, there are very, very few moments where you can take decisions because the situation is critical. Situation today is critical. It's critical because there is little confidence in the system. By confidence, it's not only for vis-à-vis the banks or vis-à-vis the authorities, it's basically you don't trust your neighbor. And in not trusting your neighbor, you don't trust the society at large. So confidence for me is number one. Confidence could be dealt with if there is transparency. There need to be certain security for your personal data, but at the same time, I'm always surprised to see how many offshore companies. You have several offices that sell offshore companies. You can go pay $1,000, you get an offshore company with a stamp, and nobody's controlling this. So this is something I would really deal with, and transparency goes with the press. It's good that we have a very vibrant press in Ukraine. Sometimes it's even too vibrant, because sometimes journalists are interested to write too fast. Sorry, I mean, that's part of the game, so we have to accept it. What do we have today? We have many banks. We have the state-owned banks, we have the Russian banks, we have the Western-owned banks, and we have private banks. Private banks in Ukraine were built, are part of groups very often. And that's kind of logical. If you were an entrepreneur, you would not trust your neighbor to put your treasury with the other person. This is correct. Now, we go back to what is banking. Banking is accepting deposits so that other people, the bank, will transfer these deposits in the way of loans to other people. It's called transformation. So that these people could build new jobs, new enterprise, etc. Now, we are not in the jungle. And unfortunately, because of the corruption in the court system, in Ukraine, very often, I wonder if we're not in the jungle. So we must have some sort of order. Because if there is no order, there is no law, and therefore nobody will trust, nobody will put his money. So these are all the things that need to be changed. So I would not take any single point, because it's a puzzle, and you need all the points in the puzzle. You cannot take one in particular. But of course, we are here to continue working together on trying to find the best way to make from this puzzle a stable country to work in.
Thanks, and welcome to the puzzle. Sergey, from this puzzle, the debt markets, how do you think? Are they open? Can they be opened? And what should be done in order to open those markets for Ukraine?
You mean foreign markets?
I mean, yeah, foreign markets.
I think short answer is they're closed. Yeah. And one way or the other, people are going to believe in that. And like speaking of that puzzle, you know, I wanted to say that it looks like a broken car. Like a car that was like built in Soviet times from like 25 years ago. And then what Dominique said, like you can fix the brakes, but the engine is broke. And gearbox is not working. And by the way, your windshield is dirty, so you don't know where you're going. And by the way, you know, people are fighting about the steering wheel. So, but this is not the car, right? Because it's more like an organism, right? Because you can ditch the car. And I think if you look at this pragmatically, you need to ditch the car. Yesterday there was a talk by Evgeniya, and he said it's not about rebuilding the country. It's about this. It's about starting the country. Like there is so much stuff that is broken that, like speaking bluntly, it's better to ditch and start from scratch. Because if you start rebuilding, there are so many conflicts, like we take any part of this puzzle, and this is just tip of an iceberg. Because there are groups of people with their own interests. You want to do something, there are people blocking you. Like things are not going to change if you're just trying to, you know, it's like Gordian puzzle, Gordian knot, right? So you have to cut it, and you have to have guts to cut it. If you're going to untangle it line by line, things are not going to happen. Let me tell you about, let's look at it at a company. Okay, we're all bankers or ex-bankers. We have like 211 companies in our portfolio. There is one company that is really broken. It's like that car. It's really broken. And you have companies that are developing really well, you know? And you have limited number of assets that you can allocate. You can give them to Georgia, or you can give them to Nigeria, to Bangladesh, to whatever. And here is Ukraine, and Ukraine is at war. And they don't know what the hell they want to be doing with their country anyway. So the only way is for people inside not to wait for some European help or American help or international banking society or president or whatever. Things have to be rebuilt from scratch, and they have to be rebuilt bottoms up. Like, everyone has to like get one thing and do one thing. I don't know, I mean, there is no easy answer. I mean, I wish someone had this answer. I think there are more questions than answers. But it looks pretty grim. And if things are not going to change, pretty soon, like, I'm pretty sure there's not going to be a country like that. And on top of that, obviously, we have, like, we haven't done anything over the last 23 years when the environment, which now looks more like a positive one, now we're in a negative environment, right? So no one is going to give money from outside because the bubble has burst. Like, new bubble is kind of like inflating globally, but it's a long way to go before it inflates and there is spillover effect to countries like Ukraine. Plus, even if there is spillover, no one is going to spill money over to a country that is at war. And if you are pragmatic, like, people don't want to, like, Europe and US, they don't want to be at fight with Russia, either like through arms or economically. It's just not economically effective. So yeah, people can talk about, like, you know, how they believe in Ukraine, how this is a good example or can be a good example. But truth is that people in the West, they don't care that much. Like, how many of you care about like some bloodshed in Uganda, you know, or whatever? Let's talk about some African country. Well, like, African country now. Like people dying like in Iraq every day. Like, do you lose your sleep about that? Like, you care about your problems, you care more about your flat will than about like 100,000 people who died somewhere in a flood. Like, seriously. So that's the situation, and that's like bitter truth. So no one is going to take care of Ukraine if people are not going to take care of Ukraine themselves. And then, like, once again, what people were talking about, quick wins. I'm not a banker to the extent that I can pick up things that can be fixed now. But like, people should talk about like two things that can be fixed now. Okay, let's wipe bloody windscreen. Okay, let's just at least understand where we're going. The next thing, okay, we're running out of gas. Luckily, there are people who are willing to give us a little bit of gas, but it's not going to be, you know, it's not going to last for a long time. Like, cut that situation with like natural gas. Like, stop subsidizing. Like you're seriously burning fuel that is super precious on something that has no economic value. So, I mean, this is pretty bad, to be honest with you, especially looking from London. I mean, sorry, I don't have anything positive to say so far. I would love to be in a position.
You know, Sergey, the question is, we need to say truth. It's not to say only positive, you know, because, you know, for me, it was, since I'm a quite new person with the civil servant, and I have never been to be there. Believe me, I always was very more to be an international banker than this, how I built my career. And during one of the meetings with donors, which we had a few weeks ago, then when we started thinking, we were there with Mitya Shinky, because I'm also the member of the executive committee for the Reform Council. And we were speaking about the reforms in the country, I was speaking about the banking sector, and the guy who was representing the European Union said, look guys, you're a corrupted country. You missed already all the previous opportunities. We already gave you so much money, and we don't trust you. Yeah. And you think that you are new, yeah? But it's for you, you are new. But for us, it's just another faces, you know, every 2-3 years, and we already tired even from this. So what could I answer to this person? I say, sorry, but I'm a believer. I'm coming here to help my country and to do something what I can do. And I absolutely agree with you that it's not about others, it's about us to bring something to this country and to make this happen. And thank God if somebody will help us do this, it will be just as was said, I think, by Timothy, or somebody said that it will be just Chimera Fund was in the beginning, that with an international help it will be just faster and the effect for the, you know, for GDP will be just not so dramatic.
Let me tell you a personal story, okay? I'm from Lugansk. I left about, 11 years ago, first to go to Kiev, and then I went to study in the US. and then I've been in London for 7 years. My older brother is still in Luhansk. He's a smart guy, seriously. Like he's 14 years older than I am, and like he's a good person and he's a smart guy. You know, he wants to get out. He wants to get to London. I'm saying, okay, I understand your intent. Okay, I'm happy to. I'm there to help. You know, luckily I have means to help. I mean, they're limited. Like they're limited for everyone. And he's like, this is fine story. He would probably kill me for that. But like, okay, let's go and buy a ticket to go to Kiev. This is step number one, okay? Let's get out of that shithole, okay? And he tells me, I have to clean my leaves because his house, you know, like it's autumn, fall, right? Leaves are falling. So his yard is covered with leaves. I'm like, are you nuts? Like, are you joking? Like the city is being shelled, right? You need to get out now. And he's talking about cleaning his leaves. Right, and then he's talking about, you know, there is no electricity at the train station, and you know, there is no ticket, there is no this, and there is no that. And he's my brother, you know, like blood is not water. But at the end of the day, I understand he is not going to move. You know, this is like harsh reality. This is like the same situation for Ukraine. You know, as much as I love Ukraine, as much as I wish it good, you know, if Ukraine, like my brother, is not going to move on its own, I'm there to help. But you know, I'm not going to move his, you know, hands or move his legs. You know, he has to make all these steps. Like international society, people with Western education waste their time, money, effort to help. They are there to support, but work has to be done here locally. And like as soon as people understand this, like the sooner the better. Because if this is not going to happen, all this kind of like there is a new level of illusion. You know, like kind of like. Old illusion they have already faded. There is new generation with new delusions. So they fade really quickly. So if people don't see action very, very soon, this is gone. Like seriously, like one thing I wanted to say, people have to start moving now. Like I've seen people, I mean, sorry for calling names, but this is like, I have nothing to do with this country in terms of like, I don't have business here, like my parents are still here, but like what I see, like how much talk can people be doing? Like you're like deputy head of presidential administration, you're walking around conferences 2 days in a row instead of getting shit done. Like I'm like, seriously, what's going on? Guys, yeah.
I've said it again. My family was with me, they went back to Paris. My little son came to, had a fight when he arrived at school. He had a fight with the other guys and girls. Why? Because he was saying, you've seen the most expensive cars in Kiev. And the other guys, you know, the boys at 11, they all love cars, and they said, well, this is not possible, you come from Ukraine. So I always say to the IMF and the World Bank and IFC, why don't you have a new development index by the number of Porsche, Cayenne, Lexus, etc. per inhabitants? That would put Ukraine pretty much on the top. Now, if you talk to, I mean, my colleagues, you know, coming and they say, well, we don't understand, you know, you're telling us it's situation is difficult, etc., and then they will see these very expensive cars, which I cannot afford, but I can, but then I would be most likely taxed immediately because my tax inspector would run after me and say, well, how did you get this car? I mean, expensive cars, because they are easy to pick, should be heavily taxed in this country. That would be step number one. There must be also some taxes on property. I mean, it's true that I understand that there must be a minimum, and you can subsidize a minimum for the heat, for the water, but in terms of volume, it should be adjusted to the number of people in each household. If you have a castle and you are heating your castle, I'm sorry, you must pay more. All of these little petty things should start now, and it's up to you to make it move. It's not up to me. Because if the richest part of the population doesn't take its burden for its country, I don't see why I, as a taxpayer in another country, should subsidize this. although we have lots of Ukrainians coming to Paris to buy very expensive things, by the way. Thank you for this.
Thanks. You know, as a moderator, I failed to receive the answer to my question. I mean, what to be improved in this draft? Because I still want to develop it. And you know, when I developed this graph, I found out, and I was expecting from you this to be told, that there is nothing about the credit crunch. Yeah, because as it was mentioned already today, the loans, unfortunately, are not in the system. There are almost no new loans. And then when I just wanted to think where to put this credit crunch, not only the leveraging of banks, but also the lack of new lending to the country, I thought, I don't have where to put it, because all of them, all of these factors, they affect the potential new lending for the banking sector, for the economy. And so my question to you, and again, starting from Rufat, is what could be done in order to restart lending to the country? This is a question which we're asking, we've been arguing sometimes with Sergey from EBRD about that, and we're saying what should be done first, the second, but how to restart lending, because without lending, there is even not much sense in the banking, because tomorrow the transaction banking will be done even not by banks, but still we need to provide the lending to new blood to the economy. What could be done? You know, if you want, from an EL point of view, from any angle you want.
Well, I just came from Belarus this morning. I covered two countries, and that can be done even there by decree. So you can restart lending by ordering lending or by announcing something. And on the way here, I was looking at the latest reports, corporate announcements, and actually was surprised. It's maybe not the very wide sample, but still. Looking at the 9-month results for some of the corporates that recently published their results in Ukraine, like Ovostar, they have only 1% drop when you compare 9 months of this year to 9 months of the previous year. And keeping in mind that Euromaidan started almost a year ago, looking at IMC, they have 55% EBITDA margin, Ovostar had 40% EBITDA margin. Milkland has a different maybe story, but still sales are 6%, I would say only 6% down. EBITDA is 19% down, but still a good margin. MHP had an EBITDA of 43% more than a year ago. So the companies like this, obviously this is just one sector, maybe just a handful of companies in one sector, but these things exist. I was speaking to a company similar to MHP in Belarus, discussing the margin and the cost of production. I said, no, don't compare it to MHP, you have different obviously cost base when it comes to labor, less than compared to Belarus. We have a much more efficient logistics and overall our business model. We're better in certain other ways, but they're very good, so by far the best in the CIS region. So the companies like this to focus on, and even them having issues borrowing. So something is, there is a credit crunch. So fundamentally, they're good companies, the experts, their prices, fluctuate, but they still are viable businesses in this environment, and they will remain viable as long as they can export and as long as they have access to export, as long as they have export routes physically. How to restart? We obviously, IFC Bank India, we cannot solve the problem. We can catalyze, but we need to catalyze others. We had difficulty recently syndicating banks, even when we bring them under our so-called umbrella. It's been quite challenging. It comes to the probably, I think Dominique mentioned earlier, the issue we're trying to solve hasn't happened just yesterday. Yes, the war was no one was expecting that to happen, but many issues have built up, so it will take some time to fix them. Unfortunately, there is no magic answer. Judicial system, again, will not take just 1 month or two, but maybe we need to do something Georgia has done. Do something drastic, learn something from their experience, not necessarily adopt everything they've done, but try to do it what fits the Ukrainian reality. I'm sure most of it will. Once the new government is in place, the leadership should show that they prepare to revamp the system. Otherwise, the banks are, okay, one or two or three may have various motivations and do some silly things, but as a community, they know what they're doing. So they will not be putting money into something where they don't see a future. They need to see projects that pay back. These guys, I mentioned, I'm sure even they are probably not investing as much as they did or they could. So overall situation has to improve. I'm not discussing the war, obviously. This is a separate issue. So I think it will take time.
Even if you will take time, the first three steps which you would do now, you know, for this country, you know, to restart the lending, you know, it could be National Bank, or who should do those steps for Ukraine?
First of all, again, what obstacles are the main for banking system? This is protection of creditors' right. This is very old statement, but unfortunately nothing has been done. It's still here. Our courts does not work, and our state execution service also does not work, even worse than courts, because even if you obtain a decision from the court, but you cannot execute it. Therefore, I believe that first and foremost, what should be done is to put an order to this system, court system, and state execution service. This is first. Second, you should understand, and by the way, Crédit Agricole example is a very good one. We should understand that while banks have their balance sheet, their assets, overloaded by non-performing loans, NPAs, we will not move too quickly with new credit. And why I say that it's a good example of Crédit Agricole. There are even some recently some speculation that we have one of the smallest rate of provisioning. It means that Crédit Agricole cheapest provisioning, making less provision than others. But in fact, the truth is the fact that we start to clean our assets in 2006, before any crisis, when Crédit Agricole Group purchased local Ukrainian bank, index bank. And we start make this home task. At that moment we show losses, and we were the only bank which showed losses. So National Bank say it's impossible because it's prohibited by law to have loss-making bank. Nevertheless, we continue our homework and we clear these assets. And now we have it like automatically because we sell all all past due more than 3 months. We just automatically sell and we continue. This is non-stop work. Now it's a bit slow and I will explain to you why. But we permanently clean our assets. And this permit us to have a new one, to issue new loans. Now, why I say that now it's a bit slow, and this is also a task which is very important to do right now. I speak about collectors. You know, we have very negative public opinion against this business. Of course, it's understandable. First of all, there's some so-called black collectors which spoil reputation of this business, which were too nasty or too rude with people, with customers, and therefore they created negative public opinion. But without this business being established in Ukraine, regulated in correct way and performed in a correct way, we will not be able to clean up our assets. Now banking system looks like, you know, your house or your apartment to which you acquired or purchased for a long time, so all these years you purchased and put new furniture. And now some of this furniture is broken, is dusty, you do not have any space, you cannot already purchase a new piece of furniture which you would like to purchase. And you continue do nothing because you do not have mechanism how to sell old furniture even for small money with discount, etc. Therefore, I believe that if we do not establish in nearest future this culture of collection business, collector's business, we will not be able to clear banking system. And all this recapitalization story will not help because investors will add capital, but bank will add assets which very quickly become bad assets. So without this mechanism, we cannot move.
You know, I would bet for developing the culture of repaying loans instead of developing the collectors.
No, you know.
But these are also the nuances of Ukrainian banking system. Sergey, what about? I mean, well, when you look from London, what you would do? I mean, would you advise three steps to do for Ukraine today in the banking sector?
I think obviously we know that there is a problem, right? Let's talk about. I mean, I don't know, but people probably understand that if three regions were lost, so it means the global banks, they have their loan portfolios in those regions. Okay, let's think, what's the economic potential of the lost area? Let's say, like, conservatively 25%. And, like, the question to Andrew, what is capital adequacy, 11%?
10%,
okay. So, roughly speaking, let's be honest. Banks just lost 25% of their loan portfolio, okay? So, which means, like, do the math, right? You're like 10.5 times below you actually burned your capital, and then another 15% of someone else's money that was put into your bank. Okay, this is like quick answer. So situation, as I mentioned before, is pretty bad. Now there are two options, right? You either admit that, and you say, okay, we're in big trouble, right? So, and then the question is like, do you try to find new mechanisms? Like if old system is not working? Like I'm a big proponent, not to come close to Kahabim Dikidze, but I think he was famous libertarian. I think that like small and medium businesses and people are going to sort things out. If system is in a gridlock, just allow people to sort things out. If system is not working, maybe some new mechanisms have to be introduced. Some, you know, okay, I'm not talking about peer-to-peer loans, it's probably like different planet, but like if there are no loans, like people go to black market, right? You just go and borrow from your neighbor. If banks is not going to give you a loan, and let's be honest, banks are not going to be given loans anytime soon, right? I mean, maybe, but like, I mean, you tell me, I expect they wouldn't. So there's not going to be any loans anytime soon. And by the way, considering the risk of Ukraine, there is not going to be foreign money injection because A, there is no bubble, B, there is too much risk. So, I mean, if I were, like mothership of any Ukrainian bank, I would like, and they're probably thinking about this, by the way, they're thinking about, you know, cutting it loose pretty soon, right? Because it's a dead wood on their balance sheet, right? Like, they already basically said, okay, we put it down to zero. There is nothing left, right? If something comes out, if we're lucky, I'm sorry for spilling the beans. I'm just saying how things are in reality, right? So this is gone. Like, if something is going to come out of it, it's basically liquidation value. So we're going to recoup something that we already lost, maybe, if we're lucky. But to be honest, like, this is zero to us. So we're not going to throw any good money after that, because we've already been burned a couple of times. And by the way, we don't see any progress anyway. It's not like we see a positive development. You only can start thinking, okay, we have a lot of money tied up in this situation, but we see that people are kind of like trying to change to the better, so there is a chance. Let's support them a little bit, because there is a chance for us to get more than zero. But if it continues to be a black hole, it's going to be zero for a long time. And unlike Greece or whatever, like we've been talking a lot about the European crisis when I was at Goldman, people were saying, yeah, let's support, I mean, Greece at least was in the European Union, right? There was this like common mechanism, people didn't want to look bad in front of their neighbors and other stuff. You know, at least they were injected something. Here, there is not going to be an injection. If anything, it's probably going to be worse because Russia is also pulling the strings into the opposite direction, right? Because it's to their benefit to show that Ukraine failed. So we need to understand that as well. It's not like, kind of like we're in neutral slash positive environment. Like Dominic said about like high steel prices. That was a long time ago when the environment was positive. Lots of money abroad and kind of like positive dynamics within inside of the country. Now it's actually, it's much worse than that. It's not even neutral. It's negative, right? So I think deregulation and like one example, I think it was coming from, I think it was Giuliani in New York. They had pretty bad crime situation in New York, right? So people were scared to go in public transportation. They decided to start doing one thing, because lots of people use subway every day. And windows were broken, there were a lot of like paint, kind of like a lot of graffiti on the carriages. And they said, no matter what the cost is, we're going to repair the carriages every day. So people who drive, who ride subway to work and back from work every day, they see that there is some kind of positive development that is visible. So whatever is the most visible, maybe not super effective, but it's visible. You know, it shows people that there is a goodwill and that there is a desire. I understand all these questions that we discussed, they're super important, but I think it takes a lot of time and a lot of effort to untangle them. There should be one issue that is quick and easy win that shows to people internally and externally that there are steps that are made for the better right now. But because if this is not going to happen, if you start tackling the most difficult problem, it's never going to happen. You know, like, let me talk like from the point of view of a business, right? Like if you have a lot of problems to resolve, are you going to start lifting like the heaviest stones straight away? Like there's been a flood, right? So you have like a lot of mess in your house or whatever. You start probably picking some easy things, right? Like if you remove stuff that is easy to remove, you don't pull the biggest thing out of the bottom of a heap, right? You start removing stuff, but at least your neighbor starts seeing, okay, this guy, he's not like sleeping all day long, he starts to rebuild his house. So maybe like being good neighbors, by the way, we want him to succeed as well. He's our neighbor, you know, we don't want mess on our street, we're going to come and help. But if you're just, you know, maybe if you're doing something, there isn't some noise coming out, but no one sees anything, you know, no one is going to come to help. So whatever other things, and you obviously are much better qualified than I am, that can be done right now, and they have maybe not super effective, maybe not super big effect in terms of influence, but they have super big effect in terms of visibility, in terms of, let's be blunt, PR, right? We need to sell the fact that the country wants to change. And this has to be done pretty soon. So just take one thing, two things, three things, not like 25 KPIs, like yesterday, Samokovich, that was a disaster. 25 KPIs, guys, what are you talking about? Three things at most, and get things done. You know, do first things first, second, third. Then people will see, you know, there is something going on.
As a matter of fact, I fully agree with you. And we tried to do something in our house. We really hope that when we met a few days ago with Timothy, I said the National Bank wants to be the role model for others. We tried to do our best. Not everything, and also in Brussels, we even said, sorry, we did not succeed in many things which we planned. I mean, let's be honest. I mean, it's not about exchange rate, you know, I hope we will stop discussing that issue, but, you know, we sent 26 banks for the for deposit guarantee fund. Someone can say, yeah, you ruined the banking sector. No, it's not we who ruined the banking sector. These are the ox owners of those banks who brought the banks to the bankruptcy. You know, who did not support them, who even did not try to support those banks because they just brought the keys and even sometimes those owners are wanted, you know, by Interpol, whatever. You know, we sent the seven banks, to the liquidation due to money laundering. You know, look, it's not about the national, not only about the banking sector, it's about the fiscal deficit, about the capital outflows. Those banks were sending hundreds of billion hryvnia, doing the cash money laundering or sending money outside of the country. You know, we do also our best in order to reform the national bank itself. As the governor Gonkley was telling to me, believe me, because we face such a big resistance, not only from, you know, from money laundering the older banks, not only even from the other institutions, but also inside the National Bank. And we try to do the best. Maybe it's not everything is still seen, and I'm not, what I'm saying, I'm a believer that we will do. We will make the things happen, as you were saying.
That I'm doing, then you need to be beating your drum. People have to know that maybe you're doing amazing things, they're just not seen. This is the problem. It's not about doing things,
about telling people what you are doing and what is going to be done next. You just mentioned corruption. I mean, maybe I haven't followed it enough, but have we seen at least one person being imprisoned or at least arrested? Like, do this publicly, arrest five, I don't want to call names, once again, not names, but anything, right? Arrest five people, prosecute them. This is going to be a big win, I'm telling you, this is going to score you more points in Europe than like tons of cheap talk. Seriously, prosecute five people. Say, okay, these are corrupt officials or corrupt owners of banks that run this country into trouble. This would be amazing quick win and beat the drum, okay?
We have time for the questions from the audience. It's such an interesting group of people. Do we have the mic?
Vlad, can I make one comment?
Yeah.
I fully agree that, first of all, you have to show for the people in Ukraine. There are many companies here who have invested, and many investments which have been made, which are quite successful. I still did not find any book, any reference on these successful investments. I remember when Sandora was built and sold. It was a great story. You have Sesamit and you have many foreign companies that came. And not only foreign, you have also local companies. Let's make a book. Make it that it shows that something happened. In a national bank, each time you have a cross-border loan, you have to register, which is a good thing in my view.
We promise to cancel it.
But we need no. If you need to register the loans for real investments that are really for investments in the future of this country, for new production, for things like this, not for the some sort of schemes. So publicity, you know, it's made in Ukraine. No? You can use the joke, but I mean, it needs to be used. Everybody knows where is Ukraine. Nobody knows exactly what there is in it outside. You have lots of hotels being built. Maybe a good publicity for people to come and visit, to bring more tourists. I know it's not easy to be a tourist in Ukraine. I must be masochistic, but after all, Mazosh was born in Lviv. Lviv is a beautiful place. Odessa is a beautiful place. Make it known. Come and see, and he would fight the story that we hear from the other side of the border that this country is full of fascists. If you come, I will say to my friends, you believe they exist? Come, I invite you.
Dominique, I fully agree with you. I put it in my notes that, to write a book about Ukraine, just to comment the last word of Sergey as well, is that sometimes to make this publicity, unfortunately, you need also to participate in the conferences and to sit and speak in front of such a reputable audience. And again, I'm sorry that I'm here and not working in the National Bank. Okay, so the questions. Do we have a mic?
I can be speaking loud if you want. My name is Mitro Strigun. I'm an expert in real estate finance in UniCredit Bank and been colleagues with Mr. Rashkovan. Thank you for talking. I've been in this awful conference yesterday either, and I remember this speechless doers, Asutkin, blah blah guys from the commission or governments, whatever. Ex-minister of economics was
question.
And the question, if the international banks are doing something in the field of protection their property rights over the assets they lost, because they're working in the real estate and there is always collateral behind, and we have the Russians that occupy the territory, so you know the people who changed their passports for the Russian. And if you are going to the international court, because local prosecution here is not performing well, but you still have time to apply to the international courts and they can arrest the assets of the Russia abroad. I don't see any actions in this field now. I've been working in the real estate execution on the local territory, and I know that our prosecution is awful. And it wouldn't change like in a while, and you have like 6 months of application term. Otherwise, it would be hard to find. If the banks are doing something to execute the assets they lost in Crimea, in Donetsk, Lugansk, because you still have time to collect the witnesses and to apply to International Criminal Court, International Court for the Human Rights Protection, in case if it's person to person. Thank you.
Okay, first of all, International Court with Donetsk and Lugansk, I believe we are not there yet, because this is our territory, this is Ukraine, and I hope that we will solve this problem here in Ukraine. Concerning Crimea, which is also our territory temporarily occupied, but the situation is a bit different, because Ukraine established a border over there, and I cannot be an expert because we have very small assets, relatively, in comparison with other banks in Crimea. We keep in Crimea even before all major things were done, and we do not play with mortgages, so therefore we almost do not have real estate. We still have commercial real estate as a pledge, but not a lot. Therefore, we continue work with this, but in our own way. But I know that those banks who have a lot of assets and big portfolios and big pledges, they collect all these cases and all the in one case, and this case is going to be delivered to, I don't know, Brussels or Strasbourg. Probably Strasbourg. No, anyway, to European International Court.
Yeah, just to let you know, tonight at 2 a.m. I was discussing with via Skype with quite famous the law professor from U.S. About such cases of annexation, whatever, which are quite. Quite unique for the after Second World War period. At the same time, if you go a little bit beyond, so the First World War and post First World War started, from South Tyrol, the issues of Poland in 1939. There are cases of the annexation of the territories which we can analyze both from the legal perspective and also even from accounting perspective, because we speak about the deposit, the rights, and it's a little bit situation quite difficult in the banking sector, but just to give you an idea, we are not yet in the courts, but at least we're on a theoretical level we discuss these issues.
Rufat, the CFO of Credit Agricole. I look at the scheme, I agree with protection of creditors' rights, I agree with issues of practices, laundering, credit parties, and so on. But as far as the issues of banking systems are concerned, I'm used to saying that banking system has two enemies. One is cash, and the other one is dollar. Do you agree with this statement, and what can be done in order to limit the use of cash and to limit the use of dollar?
Is the question to me? Or
to me, or to bankers exchange?
Can you please repeat the question? What do you catch?
Well, banking system has for me different two enemies. One is cash, the other one is dollar.
Well, any time when you are in a difficult situation, or war, people tend to prefer to accumulate cash. That's a normal behavior. You don't know what you're going to do next, you don't know if you can trust the banks. So that there's a difference between what you can do and will it be effective. At the moment, you can force people to put their deposits into the banks. I don't think it will work. What we need to rebuild is confidence. This is why, first of all, I think, let's look at the situation today. We are at war, and honestly, I mean, the subway is running, the trains are running, there is no problem with electricity in most of the places. I mean, this country is running, okay? If we were to compare with France with such a situation, I don't know if our country would be running, and I don't think any other country in the European Union. So, You have the cash, okay. How could you forbid use of cash, which is really the key question? Yes, because if you cannot use cash, you have to force it, they go through the banking sector.
Cash is also corruption.
Yeah,
tool for corruption.
Yeah. The dollar is the refugee, is you take a refuge in the dollar because you believe that the national currency will have more problems. So here again, it's the same. In psychology, in order to kill that psychological element, you need to bring back confidence. So you need to show that things are happening, that the country is running, that companies are working, etc. Back in 92, take when the Soviet Union collapsed, take what they did in Estonia. In Estonia, they said, look, we close all the banks. You have lost everything. Not a single bank was left. They recreated new banks, and they said, all your Soviet rubles, you can forget, they don't exist. Take what they did in Serbia in 2001. They closed the four largest banks, 75% of the banking sector. One of the problems we're facing here is in Estonia, Estonia became independent. The game was over. In Serbia, Milosevic was gone. The war was over. One of the problems we have here is we are at war, which is a non-declared war, with a little green man, which didn't come from Mars. We don't know where they came from. We have some ideas where they came from, the little green men. By the way, they're not so little, and they're well equipped. Well, if you don't know tomorrow where these little green men are going to stop, of course you accumulate some cash. And of course you're careful. So I agree, this is a big question. This is something we need to solve, but I don't think we can solve it today.
We mean not to use war as an excuse, you remember, from the beginning. Recently I was accused, I was named or accused to be 100-step strategy man. So that there are, you know, too many steps, and as you said, that you need to focus. But those who know myself is, we have a strategy which was developed and we're following it. One of them was, one of the parts of the strategy, I don't remember the number, is to decrease cash in this country. And another one is de-dollarization. You know, when I started working on the cash, my first day was working in the National Bank, came to work in the National Bank, it was mid-April. I just go to the management board where they discussed the strategy for the cash management, the cash operations in the country. Say, oh my God, it's something which I really need to know. I went there, there was about the cash, is the number of, the retail turnover will increase, the second is the cash will increase, and therefore, the third slide, how do you think, what was about? Was let's build a new warehouse for cash. This was about the strategy for the cash management. The second topic was I was speaking with Norwegians at Global Bank, here we don't have a Vladyslav who likes this topic, you know, to decrease the cash in the company. And they say, yes, now we have one of the lowest cash operations in the country. I mean, we are very, very successful. I said, yeah, but what do you do? You know, it's like an anecdote who started in 1973. You know, in 1973, they took a strategy to decrease cash in the economy. And they did a lot. They started from the local payment system, where the local payment system is even more important than Visa and MasterCard. They decreased the cost of the interbank operations. They significantly increased the cost of the cash operations. And believe me, we will try to do the same. Now we decrease the thresholds for the operations of cash together with the tax office from 150,000 to 20,000. We will increase the cost of the cash in the economy, and we will try to move them there. It's not one day job. But the dollarization is exactly the same. I'm again coming back to the topic of Andrei in the previous session, that we need to start stop asking the question what is the exchange rate. But without, I mean, being our assets and liabilities still in the banking sector is 45% in dollars, dollar denominated. You know, it's not a question of yesterday, and it's not a question of tomorrow to fix it. I fully agree with you, we work on in that direction. And just to give you, these slides was not to show the problems in process. We were working to show this, the path how we go to solve it. Just because it was not back to the presentation.
Thank you very much, Rossi for Ukraine. So I have a very practical question, and probably this would be a general question from the middle class of Ukraine to the banking system. So first, I'd like to bring the conversation back to the first part of the panel and to thank Evgeniya for her statement that any populist statements are very harmful. So the country, my question is how to destroy the practice of telling populistic statements and how to restore the trust in the banking system. I'll explain a bit. I have a number of friends. They say, listen, we have money, a lot of money, maybe more than a million each, and we are ready to put them into banks. We are perfectly fine with the risk of Crédit Agricole Bank. We are perfectly fine with the risk of BNP Paribas Bank. But we are not fine with the risk of the general banking system, because we do not know what to expect. The next day, they might come up and say that, listen, we will convert deposits in foreign currency into hryvnia. And you do not know what to expect. Because for the last 20 years, the country got used to the situation when officials come up and say that 13 is the level for hryvnia which is acceptable and perfect by the system, and then we see 16. Like, years before, it's all the same. So how to destroy those populistic statements, and what should be done to change the situation? Thank you very much.
Vladyslav, let me take this one, okay? I'm not from the banking system, but guys, I need to tell you something. Who is here happy to get 25% annual interest on their deposit? Raise your hand. 25%. Are you out of your mind? You're going to lose your shirt. I'm serious. Like, this is nuts, you know, this is not sustainable. You can't be pegged to the dollar. And by the way, anywhere in Europe it's like 1%, maybe 1.25, and you are getting 25% annually. Like, you're driving inflation out of, like, out through the roof. Like, it's basically free money. And you're saying, oh, by the way, we're not pissed off because, like, banking is in trouble. Of course it's going to be in trouble. You guys have caused this partially, right? By being so naive to think that 25% is a fair price for stability. This is not the price for stability. This is like super speculative investment. And you're saying, oh wow, now we're unhappy with banking system. Come on.
Like the venture funds.
It's not even venture fund. Like, venture fund is like 12% return with a 10-year lockup. You know, there is liquidity premium, there is risk premium. 25% is nowhere near. So, like, just by that measure alone, in 4 years, currency has to come down 50% to get to sustainable level. It came down, it will probably come down further if things are not going to change. And this is speaking about populism. Let's start from ourselves. We're all populists. We like free money, we like other people to solve our problems, we like to criticize other people and say, yeah, they should have done this or that. I mean, this is like, you know, this is an unreal situation.
You have an answer to this question?
No, I think having 25% interest rate is, it happens. It's fine, the real interest rate is not 25%, it should be a couple of percent. The problem was that the real interest rate was 25% for some time, it didn't amount to this problem now. So we're basically suffering getting the consequences of what we had before. But 25% by itself, it's not the only case. It happened in many countries, and it could actually go on for a long time, as long as the real interest rate is not 25%.
No, but I'm saying you can't expect getting 25% interest rate and not being afraid of losing your money. You know, there is a risk there. Like, you know, if in European bank you get 1%, there is probably little risk of you losing your money. If there is equally lower risk in Ukraine, you need to be stupid not to pile up your money into Ukrainian banks, right? That would be like perpetuum mobile. You know, this is like best business ever. You know, you borrow at 3% in Europe, you know, you suck it to Ukraine at 25%. And by the way, lots of people were doing this and were quite happy. You know, oh wow, we're a smart businessman. Now guess what? And now they're unhappy that, you know, currency devalued and banks are in trouble.
But what's even worse when you actually guarantee those deposits to some amount?
Well, there is no guarantee, right? Because there is no money in the bank. I mean, in the coffers of the government. So this guarantee is not what the paper is written on.
You know, if I may answer this question, I think is the answer is also very close to this picture. I would start stopping the elections for a certain period of time. Yeah, because when there is election, there is so much populism, which later is reflected in the decisions and later. But unfortunately, due to this puzzle, it also brings some potential problems with democracy in the country. So you need to choose what you want: less democracy or less populism. Because when there is democracy, there is always populism. You know, if I may, I want to thank today participants for the such interesting, for me quite. Fair and sincere discussion, and maybe let's ask all together that next year when we will participate in such a forum, we will not speak about this number of problems, but still we will speak about the prosperity and development of this country and the new projects, and not about the FX exchange rate. Thank you.